Yeah. Kitty, get out of here. Okay.
Meow.
This is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends. I am the Iron Hamster. That is my radio wrestling voice. And boy, we have a match today. And over in this corner, we have Dianna, the Laughing Kitty. How are you, Dianna?
Meow, it's my birthday.
It's your birthday. I'm so psyched. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Yep, I would sing happy birthday to you, but after my vocal warm-up there, me, it's all about me. I'm not going to do it. I'm just not going to do it. I'm just going to wish you a very happy birthday.
Thank you.
Glad you could join us. And
yeah.
You're on for the first hour, and then you're going to go out and party with friends and family for the second hour.
Yep. Yes, I'm going to go and have a good time and buy stuff.
and engage in the free market. All right.
That's right.
And in the other corner of the inner tubes, for the whole show, and then we're bringing someone else on for the second hour, we have Colleen. How you doing, Colleen?
I'm great. I'm glad to be here.
We're glad to have you here. And we are going hard in the paint on Stefan Molyneux, but it's the last time I'm going to say that. Not that I'm never going to mention the guy again, but here's the thing. There's this guy.
We got to get the word out.
Yeah. There's this guy named Stefan Molyneux. If you're listening on the home version on radio and not the interwebs, it's S-T-E-F-A-N Molyneux, M-O-L-Y-N-E-U-X. Stefan Molyneux. And he is probably the most famous ANCAP libertarian there is. And we're pretty much ANCAP libertarian. We're ANCAP libertarians here. And the reason we're going hard in the paint on this guy 5 days in a row, or I think it was four out of, this is we skipped a day, but 4 out of 5 days in a row. Here's the thing. He is known outside of the libertarian community. He is known, mm-hmm. like he's been talked about in Time magazine. He's been talked about in some mainstream media. And he is doing some crazy stuff that just really, really offends me and a lot of other people.
Yeah.
To the point where, you know, I don't think I can convince anybody in liberty if they're into following someone in literally in a cult-like manner to where they defend him like they're defending their parents, and he's asked them to leave their parents even if their parents were not abusive, that being the key word. I can't convince someone like that, someone who's buying a cult-like ideology and making it their whole life. I'll never convince that person that you should leave. You can't tell someone who feels that way religiously about some new idea that's really some old ideas kind of messed around and thrown into a gumbo.
Recycled.
Yeah, you can't, and then delivered with like stunning salesman-like ability with no uhs and no ums and ahs, you know, like a guy who basically, you know, what did he major, what's, Dianna, what is his major in? Is it like botany with a minor in theater tech? What's his master's in?
You were asking me. I think you might want to ask Colleen. Colleen, do you know?
It was history, actually. Was
okay,
history.
Yeah, with theater, right?
But he did study theater for a while. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
That makes sense.
So basically, this guy Stefan Molyneux has been censoring critics, using intellectual property laws to do it when he says he's against intellectual property laws. But moreover than that, to me, censoring critics, like not allowing free speech about him. And he may come after us, you know, but if he doesn't come after us, he doesn't come after any of my friends, I'm not going to have reasons to do 2-hour-long shows on him anymore. I've said what I'm going to say. Things will come up here and there. You know, for the past 2 years, we've been saying silly stuff about him here and there when he does silly stuff. But the guy presents himself as an ethicist, someone of moral high moral character to be emulated, says all parents were bad parents, says he's the first parent to teach good parenting, but he lies and silences free speech. That doesn't seem very ethical or good teaching, you know, good teaching of parenting to me. So I've coined this term to Molly. It's a verb to censor criticism when the censoring is done by someone who claims to love free speech. Like that article got mollied by Molyneux. And I think that should spread. And, you know, I call his followers Molinites. Davy Barker coined that. And I think it's pretty accurate.
Ooh,
because,
that's good.
You know, most libertarians, they write and get kind of a name for themselves. Like, yeah, they've got some people saying, oh, you're dumb, but they don't have 10 websites devoted to, I must expose that this person is a cult leader. And they don't have, you know, major libertarian scholars saying, yeah, I read his grand unified theory of liberty, the universal preferable behavior, the UPB. And, you know, if it delivered on what it wants to deliver on, it would be as important as anything from since Plato or Socrates or John Locke, but it doesn't deliver and it fails miserably. That's a critique I've seen over and over and over by people who want to see the new grand unified theory. So the reason I wasn't letting up on this, you know, and we're going to go back to like your usual fiends fun tonight, where we just kind of have fun and make fun of the government. We're going to go back to that tonight, but I really wish that hardcore fiend fans would forget about their, you know, free media that comes from me on their pod feed for a week and just let me address the bigger audience here, because what I want is when, you know, this 74-year-old grandpa who I like that guy, the 74-year-old grandpa who's listening to us on one of our 26 radio affiliates, is driving his grandkids from, you know, church to the VFW picnic, and he hears us. I want him to remember Stefan Molyneux and a guy said, me, Michael Dean, a libertarian, an ANCAP, a no-government guy, you know, a total liberty guy, voluntarist, said, I don't like this guy. So when it comes up, when he's in Time magazine again and they say, oh, this libertarian is horrible, that's what libertarians are like, which kind of is how the mainstream media paints him, I want people to have heard the opinion that not all libertarians like this guy, and he's not representative of all libertarians. And in fact, there are thousands of us who either, you know, basically think this guy is evil, like me, or you know, down to like, oh, they go, ugh, when they hear this guy's name. So we did an interview with Colleen the other day. She was an inner circle member of Molyneux's. I'm not going to call it a cult. You call it a cult, right?
I do. I've been pretty open about that.
Okay.
And I just wanted to clarify, because I called it the inner circle, but that it was never referred to that way within the group. That's just my own characterization of it.
Was it called the inner sanctum? No, I'm kidding.
No.
So what was it called?
I mean, they didn't really have a name for it. I mean, I suppose you could say there was like the Friends of FDR forum, and you could say it was Friends of FDR. But
FDR, let me clarify for the radio audience, Free Domain Radio, not Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
Right.
He's generally got he's got thousands of followers, but and people that donate, you know, he's got a bunch of people that donate and follow his every word. But if you stay in long enough, and it's not based on how much you donate getting in the inner chamber. It's how devoted you are, right? And how much work you're willing to do for them for free.
It's a combination of factors. If you demonstrate your level of commitment, I think everyone who gets into that so-called inner sanctum has defooed and defriended their old relationships and no longer associate with people who aren't anarchists and basically only have friends within that community.
Yeah. Okay, so he has like, you know, 10 or 12 in the inner sanctum of, I'm going to call it the inner sanctum, at any given time. And they have a high attrition rate. They leave the group in disgust a lot, right? Inner circle?
Yeah, it's pretty consistent in terms of the length of time. Most people are involved for about 2 to 3 years, like me. So that attrition rate's pretty constant. And that's pretty common in a lot of other cults. So
yeah. Okay, so we did an interview with the other day. It got, you know, a lot of shares on the internet, a lot of discussion on the internet, a lot of comments on our site, a lot of comments on Reddit, a lot of comments elsewhere. I read pretty much all the comments, and you know, a lot of them were like Steph bots, you know, Molinites, devotees of this guy, just like defending him like they're defending their family. Without even like listening to the episode, just responding on the title of it. But there were three criticisms that were not people just bashing it that came up a few times over and over and over that I think are worth addressing point by point. And I'll say what the three of them are, and then we're going to address them. The first was, you know, you were in the inner circle, prove it. We're going to prove it today. The second thing is, people have free will. You know, how is it bad for him to, you know, to tell you what to do when you did it? Which I kind of agree with, but we're going to get to that. But I agree with that. But the thing is, I want the bigger community outside the libertarian ANCAP voluntarist community listening on radio to hear, okay, we don't like this guy. He's kind of a cult leader, culty guy. People follow him like a messiah. like a guru, make pilgrimages to his house, give him a lot of their money, leave their parents on his behest, but they have free will and they're adults. But I just want the bigger community outside the libertarian world to know I don't like the guy and we're not all down with this. The third thing is, you know, tell us what was in the inner circle. Bring us back the secrets. And I don't want to show documents on that. There may be documents from the other guy, but you're going to talk about it. But here's the proof. Let me go back to number one now. The proof that you were in the inner circle. Today's episode, we're going to be posting pictures of you and Stefan Molyneux standing next to each other on team corporate retreats or, you know, pilgrimages right. with him. The other guy who's coming on later today, we're going to post pictures of him, like in the back of a taxi, just him and Stefan in the back of a taxi, things like that. You know, him and Stefan, like on a swing set in a playground by themselves, you know. it is absolute proof. These people, well, maybe you could say it's not proof there's an inner circle, but it's proof that they've been very physically close to the person doing something with him at the time, with Stefan Molyneux. The second thing is, Colleen was asked by Stefan to lead podcasts, which I've never heard of anyone else doing except maybe Molyneux's wife before she got censored by the Psychiatric Board of Canada, whatever it's called. He was having you lead podcasts, and I'm going to link them today in the show notes. Some like three episodes I found really I didn't want to listen more than that, but I can't stand the guy's voice. And I'm not going to link them directly because if I do, they'll like download into your pod feed if you're a fiend guy, a fiend follower and a fiend, you know, subscriber. And I don't want you to suddenly have a bunch of Molyneux that, ugh, what's that doing on my pod? But you can go link it. You can click to it and download it. And if he deletes them from his end, and that's another thing, I don't want to like post them because even though he has said before, anyone can use my stuff, he's kind of taking that back. It's like anyone can use my stuff unless I don't like it. But I'm also going to link torrents that he has out, you know, like BitTorrent stuff that he has out that have those podcasts. That's like taking pee out. Trying to get rid of that is like trying to take pee out of a swimming pool with a spoon. I mean, it can't be done. The great thing about torrents is if you want your stuff to stay around forever, like Molyneux and like myself, who also torrent everything, they're great. The horrible thing is if you like to censor people, the stuff still stays around forever. So that's my intro. We're going to get into the meat of this when we get back on the Freedom Fiends on Molyneux Chat, day 5. Last day of it. All right, worms.
Worms.
When I found the Free State Project, I knew it was the key to achieving liberty in my lifetime. It's awesome to be surrounded by like-minded, freedom-loving activists who've moved here to New Hampshire. From politics to civil disobedience, we have it all. Where I came from, it felt that no matter what I did, liberty was dying. Perhaps you feel the same way? Call 888-377-2515 now to learn more about the Free State Project. That's 888-377-2515 or visit freestateproject.org.
The Central Scrutinizer is a Soviet-style Leviathan trying to keep track of all you do. That's why I use a VPN or virtual private network from Bola VPN. Bola VPN is inexpensive, secure, and will allow you to use your computer without leaving a trail. Bola VPN is now also offering torrent seed boxes for safely sharing media with the world. And if you open a support ticket saying you heard about them from the Freedom Fiends, they'll add 3 extra days free. That's Bola VPN at BOLEHVPN.net.
Is the Freedom Fiends live radio musical worldwide extravaganza with day 5 of 5, the last day, unless he does something crazy, really, but crazier, again, nuttier, more unethical. We're doing day 5 of Stefan Molyneux Exposed. This episode is going to be called The Truth About Stefan Molyneux, from two people who were in his inner circle. And Diana's not one of the two people. Colleen is one of the two people. The other two people is coming on. The other person is coming on in the second hour. So, Colleen, I'm looking at the titles of a couple of these podcasts that you led. Stefan had you lead them. And as far as I know, I haven't listened to his 40 billion episodes. Now, I think it's like 4,000, something like that now. I haven't listened to all, anywhere near all his episodes. I used to be a fan. I was never a donator. I was never on the forum. I used to be a fan because years ago, he used to do compelling videos that made sense about liberty. And then they started getting crazier, and he started hating women in them, and he started oh, just, you know, siding with the government and things, and then using government guns of copyright against people. So the titles of this one is a kind of creepy title on his part, from 2009. It's called Colleen Leads a Discussion on Body Issues. Colleen Leads a Discussion on Body Issues While Stef Wow. Does Push-Ups. That's somewhere between sexist and just really being a Richard, just being snitty, man. Okay, there's a second one here called Colleen's Soul Opens Up to the World. He's basically, you know,
wow.
Psychoanalyze. He's not a shrink, but he's psychoanalyzing you in public and doing dream analysis, which we're going to talk about, like whether there's a basis for that or not. And then there's a third one called, you know, Colleen Leads a Discussion About Women in Philosophy. Now, why was he grooming you to lead podcasts? What was the point of that?
I believe the point of it, and we did have conversations about it, was there was, you know, he recognized that this show really was only attracting a predominantly male listenership. So he wanted me to sort of be front and center to attract, I think, more women into the movement.
Okay.
So
he was doing dream analysis, and he recorded everything, right? You said all the time.
Yes.
Like, you know, talking to his barber, things like that.
Yes.
And he did say, did he say to you or to someone else, wouldn't it have been great if we could have heard conversations of Plato with his barber while he was getting his hair cut?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And that was in that article.
That was to Greg. Yeah. Oh, the BuzzFeed article. People are saying, well, Colleen's just reiterating stuff everyone knows because if they even read that BuzzFeed article. But the person called Alex in there is you. You weren't out fully.
Me.
Yeah. You weren't out fully. The article that got taken down, you are Alex in that article. So tell me about his dream analysis, Stefan Molyneux, and his dream analysis sessions.
Okay. That is interesting. He has a sort of Jungian approach to dream analysis, that there is vital information that's held in our unconscious minds that is only revealed to us through these complex allegories and metaphors in dreams. That is not supported by any kind of science. there's lots of research on dreams that's going on, and it's still a very elusive subject, but there's no support that there's any kind of you know, metaphorical coded information in our dreams that tell us what our defenses won't let us know in our waking life.
And
is sort of his position.
So it sounds like he's kind of like into new age pseudopsychology kind of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And you have a master's, right? What is your degree in?
My degree is in psychology.
And you're going for a PhD, right?
Yeah, I'm in a doctorate program for social psychology, experimental.
And, you know, I don't put all the weight in the world on degrees, but I put some weight on them for sure. And, you know, you're studying to be a psychologist, and Stefan majored in history and had a master's degree and wrote a master's thesis, which I've read, which is mind-blowing. And as you said, mind-blowingly, what? You know, kind of like, really? And as you said before, he got an A on it because he pestered his, what happened?
His advisor or something?
He basically just pestered his advisor, and his advisor gave him an A on it without even reading it.
Okay.
And this is something that he has said himself. There's like screenshots of this. But he used to promote his site and his credibility by putting that front and center. Like, I got an A on my, my master's thesis.
I got an A in pestering people.
I got an A.
Yeah. Okay. So tell me about his recordings of you, because he may release them, or someone may release them someday, and you wanted to say something about them.
Oh, right. I've always been very aware that there's all these recordings of us when we had private conversations or, gold donator level podcasts. I guess we can return.
Yeah,
to
let's do it when we come back from the break. This is Michael Dean, Freedom Fiends, talking to Colleen and Dianna. Whose birthday it is?
Meow.
Yay! Meow. Happy birthday! We'll be back.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends. Go to freedomfiends.com to help keep it drone proof.
What sets Survival Punk apart from all those other survivalist sites? A rational, creative approach to self-reliance. Applying a punk DIY ethic to survivalism without any of the fear-mongering or tinfoil hattery that pervades the survivalist movement. Survival Punk covers a huge range of topics, along with a healthy bit of myth-busting. Survival Punk provides a ton of dirt-cheap creative solutions to common prepping problems, with an accent on the paleo lifestyle. Check out survivalpunk.com. That's survivalpunk.com.
Looking for a new home with good neighbors, no income tax, an active shooting culture with excellent Second Amendment protections, a great business climate, and less government? Then Wyoming might just be the place for you. And freedom-minded folks are already there. Founded by author Kenneth Royce, FreeStateWyoming.org encourages free trade, political liberty, and voluntary cooperation. Come bask in the laissez-faire Western culture of the cowboy state. For details, visit FreeStateWyoming.org.
Freedom Fiends, this is Michael Dean. It's Diana's birthday. And we're talking to Colleen about Stefan Molyneux. Boy, that's a lot of characters to follow in this plot. Stefan Molyneux is the so-called libertarian who I feel is giving libertarians a bad name by censoring critics, Stalinistically having things taken down that are critical of him. And then, you know, there's the whole thing of for about 10 years, people have been saying he's been running a cult. And we have Colleen here who was in the inner circle of this so-called cult. She calls it a cult. I don't know because I wasn't there, so I'm going to say it's cult-like. It's pretty cult-like to me. So, Colleen, tell me about the recordings of you that he made.
Right. Okay. So he records all private conversations
with consent and knowledge or not?
Usually with consent. I don't know if he always told people, but it was pretty much understood that if you were talking to him, it was going to be recorded. So, and while I was in the group, I sort of alluded to this before that I did think of my parents as being abusive while I was under the influence of this group.
Of his thrall. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's a lot of things that go on in the community of suggesting that things were abuse, and they believe in repressed memories and recovering repressed memories and that sort of thing. And so there are podcasts, or not podcasts, but recordings of me accusing my parents of being abusive and saying some pretty damning things. But I want people to know that if those do get released or anything, that a lot of that's going to be really taken out of context. And
there was peer pressure, right, to leave your parents no matter whether they were abusive or not.
Yeah. And there's a heavy emphasis on portraying things as abusive or suggesting that there's more abuse than you could remember.
To be clear, this guy has said, Stefan Molyneux has said, that all parents were bad parents until he came into the world to teach everyone to be good parents, right?
Right.
Yeah. Wow.
So, he actually said that. Yeah. I know. He actually said that.
There's video of that. On a channel called True Shives, which mirrored his nuttier sayings, clipped out, not out of context, but just so you could find them. And that's the one of the channels he had taken down, and then lied about it and said it was because they were giving personal information on people, which they weren't. His guy, Mike DeMarco, his right-hand man who sits by his throne, lied about it on his behalf. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of like, and he really hasn't addressed any of this stuff. And he went on the Joe Rogan show and lied about it and basically told the same thing. And so he's recording all these people in this inner circle. And so what about the free will thing? You wanted to address the, well, you know, yeah, he's kind of a jerk, but people have free will. You're all adults. Why is he dangerous?
Okay, the first thing I would want to address is it's not all adults. There are callers I've listened to as young as 14 years old in this community. And the designation of if you're 18, you're an adult is really sort of arbitrary because there's lots of evidence that our brains do not fully develop until we're in our mid-20s. So these are, a lot of them are sort of adolescents. And so they're
a lot of them live at home too, right?
Right. And they haven't launched in the world. They're more naive. And so they are more susceptible to being influenced by this kind of thing. The second thing I wanted to address is I can totally understand people's perspective that it must be just really weak-willed people that are easily led that get into this movement. And, you know, that's, you have to take responsibility. And I understand that position. But if you're interested, I would really recommend reading up a little bit on social psychology. There's something called the fundamental attribution error, the actor-observer bias, where we're more likely to characterize people's behaviors as coming from their personality traits rather than the situational influences around them. And it's sort of a bias in thinking that a lot of people have. But they've done research on cults and who gets involved, because there's a lot, this idea that it's all these people who are either isolated and they, or they come from bad families, or, you know, they can't think critically. And what they found is most people who get involved in cults are young people at transitional mm-hmm. periods of their lives who are idealistic, above average intelligence, and come from good family backgrounds. So we're sort of mistaken in how we characterize people who get into this. And it's sort of victim blaming, in my opinion.
He also, it seems interesting to me that he pretty much, when you get to the inner part of it, is telling everyone that their parents were abusive and they should leave their families and cut them off completely. Oh, by the way, he has a form letter to do that. And the guy that's coming in the second hour is going to talk about that. Did you ever see the form letter? Colleen? He has a form letter for people to leave their parents if they can't come up with the words on their own.
Right.
Yeah. Have you seen that?
Yes. Yes, I do remember that.
Yeah. And he also, I mean, it seems like he's trying to get people to get rid of their family and then become their father figure. Is there a feeling of that at all?
I think that's what actually happens. I'm not sure that it's like all that Machiavellian where he's really planning this out that way, but that is what ends up happening.
Oh, I think in his mind, he, you know, some people have said he's a charlatan and a scam and he doesn't believe any of it. I think he absolutely believes all of it. Do you think he does?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I think he's got kind of a messiah complex going.
Wow. You know, my main complaint about it too, I totally can see the, why this is dangerous, even if the people have free will. I think it's dangerous because, you know, like I said, I think it's giving liberty a black eye to the general public. And I also think, you know, he claims to have turned all these people onto liberty. He's turned a lot of people off from liberty, too. And there are people that leave his organization. There's a lot of them that leave, especially at the more inner rings of it, who are like, you know, they go back to being total status and wanting to vote and, you know, work. You know, like, I love the government. Like, really, he turns them off to all of it. And I think he's turned people off who are curious, who find him because you search Liberty Podcast and he comes up first. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's possible he's turned more people off to liberty than he has turned on, but that's just my opinion. And, you know, I can't prove it, but people always say, prove it, you know, and we've definitely going to prove when this comes out today that you and the guy that's coming on the second part were in the inner chamber. Cause we have pictures of you like hanging out on swing sets and in cars with Molyneux. and we have audio of you leading podcasts, which I think he'll probably delete, but you know, they are on the torrents. I'm not going to host them because he has said his stuff was Creative Commons in passing and said anybody can use it, but then he's reneged on that when it doesn't serve his purpose, which has inspired me, by the way, the Fiend fans listening. If you go to the Freedom Fiend site, there's a new thing on the banner at the top that's going to stay there forever that clearly states all Fiends audio, media, and text are licensed Creative Commons Attribution 4.0 forever. You know, like basically do what you want with it, and it's in writing now. It was buried on the site somewhere before, and now it's the first thing you see when you come up. You know, you can share it, you can make fun of us, you can do whatever you want with it. We're not going to have you take it down. We're not going to use the government guns on you. So tell us, Colleen, a little bit more about anything you want to tell us about the Stefan Molyneux re-indoctrination experience. I'm not going to call it a cult, but, you know, his life-changing, your life should revolve around me instead of your parents and the rest of the world stuff, mm-hmm. or especially anything that was like inner chamber specific that wasn't open to the general public.
Okay, so one of the things I really want to emphasize is this huge discrepancy that exists between how he presents his ideas to the general public when he knows there's like a wide audience of varying viewpoints and the way that he presents his ideas to his members. It's very different. He, like we've said in the past, he says, oh, I'm just telling people to disconnect from people who are abusive, and who could possibly argue with that position?
Right, right.
It's very different from the way that he presents it within the community. And I actually, I'll send you this link to it where, and he says that he always, he counsels people to have conversations with their families and get close to their families and talk about things that you know, they didn't like from their childhoods. And that's not 100% the case. And this thing I'll send you, this article that his own words that he wrote, he actually claims that having those conversations is kind of useless. And and it's like, this is how your parents are going to react when you bring this up, and this conversation is futile, and you know, you really need to turf all your unsatisfying relationships.
Yeah.
And that's really loosely defined.
He also, by omission, takes credit for things he didn't write. Like, if pressed on it, he'd say, yeah, David Freeman came up with that or whatever. But I've heard people think he invented DROs, which is a dispute resolution system. He didn't invent that, but he talks about it like, let me tell you about DROs, you know, in the inner circle, and doesn't say that was invented by David Friedman and Murray Rothbard, but a lot of people in his organization think he invented that. You know, I've heard people think he invented the non-aggression principle, literally. And, and he doesn't, he does not encourage people to go outside and look at other libertarians. Would you say that's true?
That's absolutely true.
Yeah, and like you were a libertarian, you know, you were involved in this for years, and like, you don't know, I've talked to you about other podcasts, and like, you've barely heard of them. I'm not just talking about us, I'm talking about like bigger podcasts and bigger liberty figures, more well known, and you're like, I don't know who that is, because you were in this Stef bubble, and he encourages that, right?
Yeah, when I was involved, it was all Molyneux all the time for me. I mean, I didn't really read too much outside of the group. I mean, I read other things, but in terms of other people in the liberty movement, I didn't pay too much attention to any of that.
Yeah.
So, and actually there's a podcast recently, and I think Philosophy Lines, who I've mentioned before, has put this up, where he actually says that researching criticisms of his moral arguments is lazy.
Oh, wow. Researching criticisms of his moral arguments, he says, is lazy. That's mind-blowing. Yeah.
He laughs at it. He scoffs at the idea. It is mind blowing because, you know, that's the intellectually rigorous thing to do is you research what people say, and you research criticisms of that, and you get a full picture. But he discourages people from reading criticisms of his ethical arguments.
Wow. What's the retention rate?
That is really scary.
This is
just surreal to me.
It is. What's the retention rate on the inner circle? Like, how much attrition is there? I mean, maybe not hard percentages because you wouldn't know that, but you said people tend to leave the inner circle. Tell me about that.
Well, when I was speaking to Greg earlier, he's caught me up on all this, but everyone that I knew from the inner circle back then is pretty much gone.
2009, right? Back then?
Yeah, 2009. There's one person that remains, like two people, which DeMarco is one of them.
You know, they always say if you stick around long enough, they'll give you a job. I guess that's what happened with DeMarco.
Yeah.
All right, we'll be back with more on the Freedom Fiends. Going hard in the paint on Stefan Molyneux and his ideas and why I think they're bad for liberty. Talking to two people who were in his innermost circle. We'll be bringing the second one up after this next segment and after this trip to the market.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends. So much truth, it hurts.
Hi, this is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends radio show. The internet has lowered the cost barrier for a worldwide radio show to a price approaching zero. Yet there is one arena where you still need thousands of dollars to approach the audio quality of the corporate media. Doing a live spoken show with more than one host in different geographic locations. Our program, Fiend Phone, will solve that problem, and it will be given away free. Go to fiendphone.com to see what you can do to help. That's FEENPHONE.com.
Freedom Fiends. This is Michael Dean. Dianna got a drone for her birthday. She got a drone strike. No, she's safe and well, and she ran off to go have fun with her family. With her family. That's good. And you know, I'm all for leaving bad people. I actually have a chapter called No Contact in my book, A User's Manual for the Human Experience, and it's about temporarily, with restrictions for, you know, a year or more, cutting someone totally abusive out of your life, or like emotionally abusive out of your life. But I don't think everyone's abusive and should be shut out of your life at all. And apparently Stefan Molyneux from Freedomain Radio does when you get to the inner circle and you're in the in crowd. So we're talking to Colleen, who was in the inner circle, the 10 or 12 person inner circle of this thousands of people organization. We have pictures to prove it. They're going to go up today. And she sounded a little better, if you're noticing, than the previous episode. She's part of a recipient of the Freedom Fiends Lend, Lease, Give microphone program. And she has a good mic now, and we're inviting her to come on in the future for non-Molyneux topics, just to talk about stuff as a guest. That'll happen later at some point, maybe. You cool with that?
Yeah, excellent. I'm great with that.
All right, so what do you want to say about the censorship that Stefan Molyneux is up to?
Okay, yeah, it continues. the BuzzFeed article that a lot of people have talked about has been removed from BuzzFeed. We've tried to get word on why, but no response as of yet. I think we can safely guess that Freedomain had a hand in getting it taken down. But I wanted to emphasize that Molyneux always says that critics are skipped to the front of the line. They can call in the Colin show, and he is so open to criticism that they'll have...
They don't have to wait. Yeah.
Exactly. And that is not true. Because Polly Doyle, the author of that article, actually contacted FreeDomain and offered to be on the Colin show and discuss it with them, and they blocked him. They blocked him from the site. Other people, I know somebody else had like a screenshot of they emailed FreeDomain and wanted to discuss criticisms with them, and this, you know, wasn't anyone that had come out with an article or anything, and they blocked him as well. So the idea that they're so open to criticism is a little bit false.
Yeah, and there was actually, you know, somebody conjectured that maybe Polly Doyle took his own article down, you know, to like try to get attention or something. I have an inner secret thing that's kind of, to me, proves that isn't true. Was I was chatting with Polly Doyle on Twitter, and we went to, I said, let's take this to email. I don't like chatting on Twitter. And he gave me his email address. I sent him an email. It said, subject line was reply if you got this, because sometimes emails don't get through, and I don't know, established people are actually getting them. And I signed it MWD, which is my initials, Michael W. Dean, in capital letters, which is how I signed my name since like 1974, you know, since before Mike DeMarco was born. But apparently Mike DeMarco signs things MDM. And Pauly looked at it quickly and thought Mike DeMarco was finally writing him back. And I got this email from Pauly like screeching at me. And then immediately, 10 seconds later, got an email from him saying, oh, sorry, I thought that was from Mike DeMarco. All right, what's up, man? So, unless he's very strategic, I don't think he took it down, man. I think that the Molyneux camp did it. But, you know, they're doing a lot of backdoor stuff and, like, denying it. And then that's one of their techniques, and not allowing – and then saying prove it. And then they're also, you know, when you say Stefan said something – even if his followers know he said it, and he will do this, you know, the people will be like, prove it. And that means, prove it means you have to go search through, you know, 4,000 3-hour podcasts. And that was one of the things that True Shibes was doing, the channel on YouTube, that was useful, was taking the crazy stuff and putting it just by itself on YouTube. And like, that's what he had taken down and then lied about the reasons for it.
Yep. Exactly. Yep.
So what else? Music, uh-oh. Radio. Stuff. All right. We're going to come back in hour two with more on Colleen and another innermost chamber defector who defooed Molyneux. There's more of them out there. I'm not going to interview them all. People are going to, they would become 24/7 for the 365, and I'm not going to do that. This is going to be the last one. But in hour two, we'll have another person on that you know that you were in the inner circle with.
Yes. So we'll be able to corroborate each other's stories.
And we have pictures of him on swing sets with Stefan Molyneux, reliving
adorable.
Child.
They That's
are adorable.
So cute.
They really are really cute. Recreation or therapy? You be the judge. On Freedom Fiends, hour two coming up next.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolf. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
Creamy Radio Audio. Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Fiends has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message. With articles on microphones, preamps, recorders, mastering, recording remotely over the internet, doing a podcast, even getting a show on actual radio, the Freedom Fiends show you what they use and where to get it. Whether you're a talk show host, voiceover artist, podcaster, evangelist, or just want to record your loved ones for the ages, at Creamy Radio Audio, the Freedom Fiends will help you make the most of your sound. Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
Freedom Fiends, going hard in the paint on Stefan Molyneux. If you don't know, if you're just tuning in, and this is the last hour of the last show, I'm going to go all Molyneux all the time. We're going to go back to our usual zany stuff of talking about how Obama's a communist and his feet stink. Starting tonight, my wife and I are going to be taking over for Derek J, who's off celebrating something in the city of brotherly love. And so we got something special here. We're talking about Stefan Molyneux, internet philosopher who has an empire that he's built that seems to have a lot of weirdness going on. Like, he's saying some kind of misogynistic things, and he's saying some kind of status things, and he's doing some kind of status things, like using government guns, copyright laws to silence critics. I feel like if your philosophy's as strong as he says it is, it should be able to weather criticism. The free market should decide. And a lot of libertarians don't want to talk about this. They're like, yeah, he's a bad guy, but, you know, there's better things to do. We need to complain about the government. No, we complain about the government all the time. I want to take a week, and this is the last hour of it, to complain about Stefan Molyneux. So we have a special treat here. We have Colleen, still from the first hour. How are you doing, Colleen?
I'm doing good.
Good. She is the she was in the inner chamber, the 10 or 12 person inner sanctum of this many thousand people community. And this isn't just an internet thing. Like, she traveled and met with him, and people did pilgrimages. And we have another one of those people here, Greg. Are you here, Greg?
I'm here.
Excellent. You can speak up a little closer, please. Right. And Greg was also an innermost chamber member. So when was this, and when did you leave?
I started listening to the show in 2007. My first time meeting Stef was in 2008, and I met him a handful of times, maybe 5-6 times in person, and then I left around, I'd say, 2012.
Okay, so people, the first question that we didn't really address in the first time with Colleen on the first show last week, people said, prove it, prove you're in your innermost chamber. First of all, we've kind of established that Colleen definitely was. And we have pictures. She's led podcasts. They're on the internet. They can't be taken down because they're on torrents. Colleen, was Greg in the innermost chamber?
Yes, he was.
All right. And we also have pictures of Greg on a swing set. And have you seen the pictures, Colleen? Did I send them to you?
No, I have
okay.
Not.
I'm going to send them to you right now while he's talking. And I want you to confirm, yes, this is Greg on a swing set with Stefan Molyneux. So, Greg, tell me about the video you're in that's on the True Shives channel, if people want to find it, about the economics of DeFooing. DeFooing being Stefan's term for leaving your family of origin, which he encourages everybody to do, whether their family was abusive or not. So go ahead.
Sure. Well, that was actually my first time ever talking to Stef on voice. It was my first podcast I was ever in, and my
first
time chatting with him.
Were you nervous?
I was. I was. It was I. Because I'd been listening to hours of this guy's podcasts, and I finally got to talk to the guy.
Ooh.
And the call was it was me. I was quite stressed about DeFooing because I was about to go into college. College was very expensive, and I was trying to figure out what to do about that. And he goes through the math, and I'll just run through some of the points of his math onto why DeFooing would actually be an economically good decision for me to make. he said that, you know, just assume $500 a year on presents to them over, let's just say they live another 25 years. That's $12,500. He said, if you invest that with 8 to 10% compounding interest, you could triple or quadruple that over a year. So that's $25,000 to $35,000 saved on birthday presents. Then if you factor in time and phone calls and visits, traveling, things like that, you've got $250,000. He said, if you add emotional pain and suffering and therapy costs, you've got $2.7 million. And then he says that if I don't defoo, I'm going to end up with a woman with a bad family. And there's a quote.
Wow.
There's a quote that says, if you have not defooed, no good person will want to marry you. So you double that, he says, because you have to count for two bad families that you're saving. So that ends up with $5 million, which I was in a pretty rough economic time after I had defooed. And I kept thinking back on that, like, when's this going to roll in? When am I going to start seeing the benefits of this defoo that I had been promised, right?
Wow.
Yeah, so that was my first call. It was one of the True Shibes videos, and because Steph and Mike have been sort of lumping True Shibes in with some of the abusive channels, and Steph even said, I've got to protect my callers. I was one of the callers on that video, and I was glad that it was out there. Yeah. I was glad that, and so,
he's being a parent figure. He's saying, you can't decide what is good for you. I'm going to decide for you.
Right. And I was glad that that was out there, and I didn't feel threatened in the least. I'm sure he felt threatened by the existence of that, but I think that it's dishonest to loop, to group True Shibes in with
It is
abusive stuff.
So he's blocked your IP. You can't view his site. When did that happen?
That my IP address block?
Yeah.
Must have been 12 hours or so, 18 hours after my call in to the Free Talk Live show.
Yeah. So tell me about the 5-minute meditation. Both of you remember this, the 5-minute meditation podcast on why you should leave your family no matter what.
Yeah, well, Colleen also remembers this. Do you want to jump in, Colleen?
Sure. Yeah, it was, they got a lot of heat for this. I'm not sure if it's still out publicly, but it was basically a meditation that he adapted, I think, from the Bradshaw book. Was that it?
I think it was from one of the Inner Child John Bradshaw things, like feeling the shame that binds you or something.
Yeah, and you were supposed to imagine yourself leaving your family behind and approaching like this beautiful area where philosophy is with great relationships. I mean, you probably remember a little bit more in detail than I do.
I remember a specific part that was like, imagine the house where you grew up. Now imagine you see your parents and you wave goodbye to them or something like that. Am I totally off base on that, Colleen?
No, oh, yeah, I remember that.
Mm-hmm. And it was in a soothing voice, like to be used as a meditation to listen to.
Yeah, right. I think the podcast was even called FDR Meditation or something like that. And I don't know if that podcast is still up there. I would actually bet no, but I'm sure it's somewhere out there.
He's been doing a lot of trying to take pee out of the pool of the internet of, you know, like trying to craft his message going forth by blocking people and editing things and removing things. But they're not all gone because a lot of them are, all the audio stuff is on torrents, which he has encouraged people to share. And there's no way he can take that off. That's up forever because it's shared on other people's sites, not on their sites, but on their hard drives. And there's also something called archive.org, which is a site that kind of spiders the internet and saves snapshots of sites at certain times. Tell me about the site that you're going to send me a link to that I'm going to put in this episode show notes.
Yeah, well, it's an archive.org snapshot of Free Domain Radio in February 2007, which is very close to when I started listening. I think I started listening in May of 2007. And there's a link to a new feature, Ask a Therapist. So you click on that link and it says, questions about mental health? My name is Christina, and I am pleased to offer advice to the listeners of Free Domain Radio. I am a licensed and practicing psychological associate with over 14 years experience in the field of mental health. I will respond to selected emails on the Free Domain Radio board. And I think that's important to put out there because that gave a lot of credence to what Steph was saying about this psychological stuff. So even if it wasn't coming directly from Christina, in a sense, it had the endorsement of Christina,
that's
a 14-year...
His wife.
His wife, yes.
Who's a licensed therapist in Canada. Now, that's also important because she was censored by her licensure board in Canada. She didn't lose her license. I'm not saying she should. I'm not making a judgment. I'm not saying anyone should be arrested or put in anywhere or have anything taken away from them. But wasn't the final result of that that they were basically saying, no, we're not therapists. We're not practicing therapy here.
Colleen knows a lot more about that than I do. So
Colleen,
the final result was she accepted a professional reprimand. She pled guilty to the charges. And then they had her, she had to go back to school for a while, take some kind of course. She had to have a mentor, and it was all at her own expense. And if she didn't comply with those, then she would have had her registration suspended for a period of 6 months, I believe. And when this was brought up on the Joe Rogan show, Steph sort of characterized it as the board agreed that DeFooing was consistent with best practices, which is not at all in the decision, which is available online.
Yeah, so there's a lot of video lately of Steph, I'm not going to say lying, but I'm going to say stretching the truth to where anybody who knows anything about it goes,
right. Can I say lying? Because I think you're lying.
It was a lie.
And I think there was another lie that's worth pointing out, is that in the Joe Rogan show, he was talking about DeFooing, and he gave a bald-faced lie about the number of times DeFooing has come up. He was asked about how central DeFooing was, that kind of thing. And DeFooing, for your listeners, is, you know, the cutting off of your family of origin. And he said, oh, well, after it's important to remember that after 3,000 podcasts, this topic only came up 3 to 4 times. And that's nonsense.
Wow.
That is utter nonsense. I mean, I think there were at least 6 podcasts with me and Colleen combined talking about the DeFoo.
Well, yeah. there's a five part series that he did called something like, but my family were good to me or something like that. What is that one called? Do you know that one?
But my parents were really nice.
Yeah. Yeah. Which
that's
is
what it was.
Which is, you know, him dealing with when people say that, his reply of why your parents weren't nice and you should leave them. That's five podcasts right there on itself. Then he did a bunch with you. And I've heard it a lot here and there. I interviewed the guy, you know, 2 years ago, and he, you know, he basically at some point like started psychoanalyzing me and said, you know, well, maybe you had a bad childhood, like immediately brought that up. Like, I'm just a guy interviewing. I'm not part of his organization at all. And he brought that up and I kind of quashed it down. I didn't want to talk about it in public. But so tell me more, Greg, about the peer pressure to DeFoo.
Well, this is a little bit more subjective. It's hard to point to any one sort of thing in this, but there was I felt a social pressure to DeFoo. I did feel that, you know, I was both considered a lesser member because I hadn't DeFooed. In fact, of our friend circle, Colleen's and my, I was one of the later ones to DeFoo. I felt like I was sort of a straggler, or that I was a lesser member. And then the moment after I DeFooed, I felt much more included in the, you know, closer group. That's very hard to prove. But
what kind of responses did you get when you posted on the board that you had DeFooed?
Well, I posted in the gold donator and diamond donator board or something like that about that I had finally DeFooed, and I got, you know, pictures of fireworks. I got people congratulating me.
Yeah.
Anyway, I hear the music.
There it is. We'll be back with more on the Freedom Fiends after this trip to the free market on Freedom Fiends Radio. Worms.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends, and I'm beaming these words into your cerebellum.
Hey, this is some Squiscar Squig Elves from Death Clocks, and you are listening to the Freedom Fiends on the, you know, the radios. And I guess it says worms now, so there you go.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Fiends now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed,
buy sheep for sheep on sheep,
and 2 designs for the Freedom Fiends. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists. It's only $10 for 5 buttons, including shipping.
Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says buttons.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Michael Dean, Freedom Fiend, broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker, and we're talking with Colleen and Greg, who were in Stefan Molyneux's innermost chamber of chosen few in his worldwide philosophy, internet philosophy, re-indoctrination system. I'll call it that, because it is all about fundamentally changing yourself to his whims. And Greg was talking about social pressure. Tell me a little bit more about this social pressure of how he uses horizontal enforcement of the group members to make you do what he wants to do.
Well, before the show, Colleen and I were talking and reminiscing about it's how hard it was to remember all the little permutations of 3-4 member calls. And it was, they were spontaneously organized, and it was something like, hey, guys, we need to talk about Bob or something like right. that. And we would talk for an hour or two about what to do.
Other with members. The problem.
And one of whom was in the middle of a psychotic episode. And, you know, we need to figure out what we're going to do to deal with this. And, you know, I remember Stef in that conversation saying, well, this is no longer a philosophy can no longer help him. This is a medical issue. So we can't really help him anymore. So, you know, little things like that where if someone was on the outs, as I mentioned in my Free Talk Live, you know, you just stopped getting, and I experienced this for, I don't know, 4 to 6 weeks after an incident. I just stopped getting responses to my IMs to friends.
Yeah,
and then
shunning.
All of a sudden, yeah, and then all of a sudden I was back on the in and, you know, got responses again. It happened to friends and, you know, that was the sort of horizontal influence that I experienced. Which, at the time, if you've lost all of your friends from before FDR, I had dropped out of school, I had stopped talking to my family, my friends at Freedom Main Radio were really all I had, so it was it was so crushing for a month to just... I basically had no one to turn to.
So basically, the thing in Freedom Main Radio, once you're in deep, is they get you to cut off all outside ties and make them your social center and your support group, and then they will shun you and cut that off sometimes if you don't do what they want. Is that correct?
One thing I wanted to add to that is, although I can't really substantiate this because of privacy concerns, but this, I know at least two instances of people who have experienced being ejected by the group or shunned by the group and find themselves entirely isolated who have ended up in mental hospitals.
Yeah, and a lot of the stuff that people would say to you, oh, prove it. You don't want to prove it because it would be outing someone and giving personal details. And you didn't record the conversations, unlike Molyneux, who records almost everything you said, even private conversations.
Right.
Yeah. So what did this disapproval extend into? Like, you said something about makeup and what movies you watched.
Oh, yeah. It's just every little choice that you made in the group, whether it would be your interests or how you presented yourself, he was intensely psychologized. So there was a lot of discouragement I was discouraged from wearing makeup, or I know I was questioned a lot about one time I wore high heels. He looks at tattoos as indicators of child abuse. There was
he also looks at if you're into martial arts as you just like hitting people. He said that. I've heard
right.
that.
Right. And there was also a huge controversy on the board. Somebody posted a Family Guy clip, and he was basically leveling the accusation that anyone who found this funny was a sadist.
I love Family Guy.
Yeah.
Wow. So it sounds like he's telling you to get rid of your parents, and then he's making decisions that a father would make for a young child or a teenager when you're an adult.
Well, I mean, I suppose like a really mentally abusive father.
Yeah, because, yeah, yeah.
You know, accusing somebody of being a sadist is pretty serious. Yeah. So,
well, there was a podcast about that Family Guy clip where actually I think it was another Inner Circle member was taking quite the issue of being called a sadist. And I think that podcast is still up. And this listener brought up the, I think, an astute point in retrospect that Steph liked playing, shooting video games, some first-person shooter. And it's like, wait a minute, if you like playing this first-person shooter, isn't that sort of a violent art form as well? In fact, you're in the view, you're looking at it from the point of view of a shooter. So anyway.
That's, yeah, yes, but he's evolved enough to watch it without being corrupted by it.
Yeah, he had some silly argument about why that was okay. Everything that he did was obviously okay, and he was...
What's he think about gun owners, really quick? Has he ever said anything about that?
I think he disapproves a lot of gun owners.
That's not very libertarian.
Yeah, I can't recall specifics, but...
I do. We had some private conversations about that. He thinks it's...
You're listening to The Freedom Fiends, an invigorating alternative to those other shows.
When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the fiends will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
Freedom Fiends. Going hard in the paint. Going hard in the paint. That's a basketball metaphor for competing successfully in a crowded area right under the basket. We're going hard in the paint. That's if you don't know about today's hip-hop vernacular, we're going hard in the paint on Stefan Molyneux, internet philosopher king who has a many thousands deep group of young people donating to him and following his every word. And then there's an inner ring that's not based on donations. It's based on devotion and willing to basically do free work. And we have two of the people who were in that 10 or 12 person innermost sanctum of Stefan's brain and hanging out in his living room and going on picnics and going on nature hikes. We have Colleen and Greg, who have defected and come back with unique knowledge. And you guys want to talk a little bit about Molyneux's opinion of siblings. Go ahead, Greg.
Well, actually, I think Colleen should lead in with this. I think she has a little bit more and to add it first, and then I've got some knowledge as well.
Yeah, there's a lot that's been said about Steph's view on parents, but he also has talked significantly about siblings, particularly older siblings. And basically, in some podcasts, he's suggested that if you were an older sibling who teased or tormented your younger sibling at any point, you're basically irredeemable. Your soul is permanent. Your soul is permanently corrupt.
Then the world is irredeemable and permanently corrupt.
Right. And these podcasts had a real significant impact on people. My boyfriend at the time had been an older sibling, and you know, he could remember instances of teasing his younger siblings. And you know, he had a real crisis after this podcast came out, because we regarded Steph as such this high authority on these moral issues and psychological issues that he started to question, you know, whether he was, you know, a corrupt person or an evil person or a sadist. You know, Steph regularly levels these accusations of being a sadist or being corrupt at people for little things like that.
Yeah, I had the experience of being an older sibling, and I remember very, very vividly those sorts of podcasts where I don't know what the word was. Was it unredeemable? Was it permanently corrupt? Things like that. But the argument was that if you were 2, 3, 4 years older than your sibling and you teased them, bullied them, whatever, that, yeah, you had a prolonged period of hurting someone who was more vulnerable than you were. So that, you know, that you can't come back from that was the argument.
Yeah, and I'm not arguing in favor of like, oh, boys will be boys, kids will be kids. You know, I think bullying is not a good thing. I'm not endorsing it, but all siblings throughout history, throughout the world that I've seen have done some of that. I'm not saying it's good because it's common, but I reject the idea that someone is irredeemable for what they've done in their past. Like, literally, I have friends that have murdered people and have gone to prison and come out, and they are redeemed, and they're not murderers in their heart of hearts anymore, and I don't believe they'll do it again. I don't think anyone is unredeemable. I think Stefan Molyneux is redeemable. I think, you know, the first thing he could do is stop lying and come out and tell the truth and take off a little few layers of ego and smugness and address the things that everyone knows he's doing instead of going and lying about it. I think anyone's redeemable. But so he has this thing, he encourages this idea that some people are permanently broken and unredeemable. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah, and most people are.
If you take
his words at face value, if you've ever teased your younger sibling, you know, most people have done that if they're an older sibling, or supporting the state in different ways, those people are, some of them are permanently corrupt. Would you agree with that? Is that a fair statement, Greg?
I think it's absolutely fair, but I also think that there was wiggle room in that I was an older sibling, but towards the middle part of my tenure at FDR, Stef had much more ill thoughts and words about my brother, who was not on board with this stuff, than for me, right? There are a couple of podcasts of him talking to me about my brother and, you know, walking me through his corruption because he was defending my family and my parents. So,
right. You're irredeemable unless you're a donator.
Right. So, all of this stuff, these hard and fast rules were bendable, right? Mm-hmm. Your choice in art reflects poorly on you unless, you know, you want to defend a first-person shooter. You know, all these sorts of rules are bendable when it comes to
bendable him for him. Members. Yeah. Well, I mean, the biggest thing that's come out lately is he has done hours and hours and hours of talking about the illegitimacy and the immorality of intellectual property laws, and basically saying, you know, if you put something out there, it's like, he doesn't use the message in a bottle idea, but you know, that you put something out in the world and it's out there and you can't own an idea or your words that you've said. And he said, people can share my podcast. They can do whatever they want with them as long as you spell my name right, which is kind of funny because his last name is hard to spell for a lot of people who didn't grow up in France. And, you know, he said this, but then he's saying, well, no, but not if you criticize me with it. You know, he's making he's making a career of making these grand statements of I'm really cool and these are my ideas, or you can't do this, but then he does differently in his he does the opposite when he wants to.
Right.
Yep. So romantic relationships, what's his attitude on that? You know, a lot of things that have been called cults in the past have done like arranged marriages or said, you know, this person should be with this person, but he doesn't do that, but he does kind of the opposite of you shouldn't be with this person. Talk about that a little bit, about how that works in the inner level.
Sure. Yeah, there's, when you mentioned horizontal reinforcement before, it's well known in the group that Stef will kind of hold conversations or calls about other members in the group where they basically analyze their romantic relationships and talk about why those relationships are bad or based on codependency and that type of thing. So you know that your romantic relationship is being really heavily monitored in the group, and they're trying to seek out evidence that it's unhealthy. I don't know why there's this obsessive preoccupation with that, but I know that Freedom Main was responsible for at least a few breakups. I mean, I include myself in that we, my boyfriend at the time and I both got involved in the group together. And then we got to a point where we were just paranoid because we got the message that Stef did not approve of our relationship. Ugh. And that sort of precipitated the breakup. And I know that's happened to several other people.
Well, Colleen, I don't remember any one reason why you, because I was in FDR longer than you were. I don't remember any one particular reason why you sort of got on the outs with some of the other inner members, but I do remember being privy to and present to conversations about your budding relationship with your now fiance. And there was definitely an implication that you were rebounding, or that it wasn't, that it was you sort of acting out in your false self. That wasn't Stef in those conversations, just to be clear, but it was the sort of group, the inner group people discussing that in that way.
Right.
And he encouraged that, right? Like, this isn't, you're not talking about some rogue group.
Colleen and her now ex-boyfriend, but boyfriend at the time, left at one of the barbecues, he wanted to, chat. So what did you guys think of how they were interacting with each other?
Stef wanted to analyze it.
Yeah. To make you feel self-conscious, Colleen, but yeah.
Man.
I mean, I'm aware. I know that all that stuff was going on.
Yeah, sure.
So.
Wow. So tell me something more. Tell me what did it look like? And that's not just a visual term, but what did it look like in these in the same room meetings of inner circle people? I mean, we have a couple pictures. We have Greg on a swing set swinging. That is a cute picture.
So cute.
Swinging with Stefan Molyneux. And we have him in the back of a taxi or a car with Stefan Molyneux sitting right next to him. I don't want to say rubbing up against him, but no, like touching, squished next to him in the back of a car. So yeah, they met, they knew each other. They were in the same location. What went on in the inner members only in-person meetings?
Well, the most stark visual that I have when I keep thinking back to these meetups is his living room was laid out with one big armchair in the corner and a couple of couches with like an ottoman in the middle, something like that. And Stef was always in that corner armchair holding forth, as usually one member or a couple were discussing personal issues or on a more abstract level, talking about the sort of next steps for freeing the world. And I'm going to send you a link to an article written by Murray Rothbard about his time in Ayn Rand's cult and some of his descriptions of what it was like to be in those meetings with Ayn Rand are very reminiscent in retrospect to what it was like at these barbecues and at these hangouts. Can you do you want to add more to that, Colleen?
Yeah, I mean, everyone who's there, I don't want to say everyone, but most people who are in attendance are very worshipful, I think, of Stef. And we all kind of wanted to gather around him, and we all kind of wanted to have those one-on-one conversations with him. So, and a lot of the pictures that are out, everyone's very happy, smiley-faced. And I just remembered, I kind of wanted to address that we were very much encouraged to present a happy front for
to the world.
And like, we were encouraged to use our own profile pictures, not just like avatars that were cartoons, but of our own face and smiling in the pictures to show that how people look who have found happiness and freedom.
Wow. Do you remember that You Are Full of Treasure podcast, Colleen?
I do.
Yeah, it was with another inner circle member, grumbling about his difficulties dating. And at one point, Stef said, "Well, why were you attracted to me?" And the answer ended up being because he was really happy.
Yeah,
right. And then he's like, "Well, if you're going to attract people, if you're going to convince people that these crazy things like anarchism, atheism, are accurate and true, you need to get past them. You need to show a happy face, because if you're a grumbly anarchist, no one's gonna fall for that."
Do you think
he didn't say fall for that?
Do you think Stefan is do you think he is happy in his relationships personally?
I don't know.
Yeah, I have no idea.
I can't say that
he wants to know all about yours, but you don't know about his.
Yeah.
I can't.
Go ahead, Greg.
I can't say that he seems to be very terrible at sustaining friendships.
All right.
At least in my experience.
We'll be back on the Freedom Fiends with the redemption in the third act on two people, the truth about Stefan Molyneux, from two people who have left the innermost chamber of his organization.
Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean. This is what radio sounds like now.
Love the Fiends and want to help out? We do take donations and we put them back into our Liberty Projects. You can make a donation by clicking on the spinning coin on any post. But what if you want to help, but you ain't got no cash? Or you made a donation and you want to help more? Here's how you can help. download and seed our torrents to help keep us drone-proof. There's a Torrent Club link at the top of FreedomFiends.com. You can also blog the Fiends and share episode links on Facebook, Twitter, and elsewhere. You can rate and review our movies on Amazon and IMDb. You can rate and review the Freedom Fiends and our songs on iTunes. That really helps a lot. You can buy our movies and share them with friends or give them out as gifts. And one of the best ways to spread liberty is to buy a bunch of Freedom Fiends buttons and give them out as gifts. Wholesale prices are available, and you can also comment on our site, or better yet, comment about us on other sites. And please email the site link to all your friends. Thanks for helping spread the Fiends message worldwide to as many liberty people as you can, especially to those who don't yet get it. You rock.
This is Michael Dean on the Freedom Fiends. This is the redemption in the third act. This is the last segment of all Molyneux all the time that I'm going to do, unless he gets nuts again. But I don't want to do that. I want to go back to talking about kitty cats and how Obama is a socialist and a liar and his feet stink, which is what we do best. But once in a while, we got to do some real journalism here. So first of all, before we go into the redemption in the third act, Colleen, you did get the pictures that Greg sent of him on the swing set with Stefan Molyneux. Is that your friend Greg? Was he in the innermost chamber with Stefan Molyneux? And is that Stefan Molyneux?
Yes.
All right.
That is Greg. Yeah.
All right. So, Greg, how is your life now that you have left the re-indoctrination program of Stefan Molyneux's Free Domain Radio?
Well, I can just throw out a few facts. I'm re-entering school on Tuesday. I'm going to be studying journalism.
Nice.
Hopefully becoming a journalist. At least that's the plan now. Who knows what I'll end up doing. I'm in a relationship. I just celebrated my 3-year anniversary.
Cool.
Actually with someone I met at Free Domain Radio, and we're both reconnected with our families. I reconnected with my family about a year and a half or so ago.
Is your mate left Free Domain Radio or still involved?
She's left as well.
Good. Okay.
Yeah. So we both reconnected with our families, there was a lot of catching up to do, and I've reconnected a lot more recently than Colleen was, and it's been great. I've visited back home I'm originally from Indiana, visited home 3 times now, and I'm just really glad that I've reconnected. I really love them, and I was convinced at one point at Freedom Main Radio that I did have a bad family, but I can see now that I was just really cared for, really loved, and I love them as well. And I'm glad that I reconnected.
Excellent. Colleen?
I went into this a little bit on the last show that we did. But yeah, since I got away from Freedom Main and reconnected with my family, and they were completely ready for me to come back, they were totally prepared with all the information about cults. I've had a better than ever relationship with my family. It's a lot more open and close than it ever was before. Like I mentioned, I'm starting a doctorate program right now in psychology, and that's all going really, really well. I'm getting married next year in May.
Congrats.
So thank you. Yeah. So, I mean, comparing my life now to how I was when I was in Freedom Main, where I was isolated and paranoid about the world, it's 100% better. Making lots of friends and meeting new people, and I'm so much happier than I was when I was in that whole mess.
If you guys had a crystal ball and could see the near future, like an hour from now, do you think that Stefan Molyneux will be listening to this podcast and psychoanalyzing all 3 of us and saying what's wrong with us with his innermost chamber members, or do you think he will be trying to have them not hear it?
I think his employees will screen it first.
You think what?
Oh, no. I was just saying, I think his employees will probably screen it for him first and then give him the relevant parts. Yeah, go ahead, Colleen. What do you predict?
Yeah, I mean, I sort of was thinking he probably already has psychoanalyzed me and possibly Greg with his inner circle members and why we're doing what we're doing and how we're so deeply angry and we hate the truth and all this. So, you know, that's the kinds of things he would say about his critics before, I know, are being said about me now. So
what did he say about his critics?
There was a forum for a long time called Liberating Minds that he actually tried to have taken down. And he characterizes people as trolls with nothing good in their lives, nothing particularly to live for, and just like warped and distorted personalities that wanted to attack anything that was good because they hated themselves so much, that type of thing. So
he believes he has a direct line to truths that other people don't have. Would you characterize that as true?
Yes, for sure.
All right. Yeah. And this is, you got any closing statements there real quick, Greg?
No. I mean, I hope that more people can, you know, tell their stories and, you know, talk about this openly.
Excellent. This has been the final segment of All Molyneux, all the time, on the Freedom Fiends. Talk radio musical extravaganza. We'll be back in 10 hours, not talking about Stefan Molyneux. And I'm really glad we did this, though, you guys. I'm really glad I got to know you and talk to you. And thank you for your courage to come on here, because I'm getting a lot of critique. I know you guys probably are, too. Thanks for doing that.
Yeah, thanks for having us on.
Yep. Yeah, thanks for having me.
Worms.